Dear students, in this session I am going to explain some objective questions based on the chapter transmission of heat. We know that heat is transferred from one part of the body to another part or from one body to another body by generally three methods, which are conduction, convection and radiation. In conduction, actually heat is transferred from one part of the solid to the another part without the movement of molecules. Here actually energy is transferred from one part to the other part without molecular movement. But in convection, heat is transferred from one part to the other part of a solid with the movement of molecules. In radiation, heat is transferred from one body to another body without the presence of a material medium. If a material medium is present between the two bodies, actually heat is transferred by conduction, but heat is transferred from one body to another body without the presence of a material medium. That process is called radiation. In conduction, now let us imagine a rod having uniform cross section. Let A represents the area of cross section of the rod and L represents the length of the rod. Let Q represents the quantity of heat energy conducted through this rod, and this quantity of heat energy, which is conducted from one part to the other part of the rod, is directly proportional to three factors. It is directly proportional to area of cross section of the rod and also directly proportional to the temperature difference between the two ends of the cross section. Let T1 represents the temperature at one end and T2 represents the temperature at the other end, and heat is transferred from, say, let AB represents the rod A to B, then naturally T1 is greater than T2, so the temperature difference is T1 minus T2, and it is also directly proportional to the time interval for which heat energy passes, and let small d represents the time for which heat energy passes. It is inversely proportional to the length of the rod or the length of the cross section, and here the length is marked as L. So we can write Q is directly proportional to A into T1 minus T2 into small t divided by L, or we can write Q is equal to lambda into A into T1 minus T2 into small t divided by L, and here lambda is the coefficient of thermal conductivity, or that is simply the thermal conductivity of the material. Now in this conduction, we can find the answer for almost the entire questions by using this single formula. That is, the amount of heat energy conducted through a cross section A in time t is given by Q is equal to lambda into A into T1 minus T2 into small t divided by L, where L is the length of the cross section. Can you tell what is the unit of lambda? I am going to write the equation for lambda. Lambda is equal to, I cross multiply this equation, Q into L divided by A into T1 minus T2, right here, T1 minus T2 into small t. Then what is the unit of Q? Q is the amount of heat energy conducted through the rod, and that is equal to joules, L meter, area meter square, temperature, that is Kelvin, time second. So joule meter by meter square into Kelvin into second. So we can write like this, joule by second into meter into Kelvin. What is joule by second? That is actually watt. So the unit is watt, meter raised to minus 1, Kelvin raised to minus 1. This is a unit of thermal conductivity. And we can find the answer for all the questions by using this single formula for the amount of heat energy conducted. Now I am straight away entering into the questions. While discussing the questions, I will actually tell you the theory behind the questions. Now the first question, the portion between the two walls of the ferrous black body is evacuated. This is to prevent the loss of heat by, three statements are given, one is conduction, two convection and three radiation, and some choices are given. 1 and 2 are correct, 2 and 3 are correct, 1 and 3 are correct, all the statements are correct and all the statements are wrong. Now before going to explain this question, I will tell you what you actually mean by a black body. A black body is one which will, now you can imagine a body, if some heat radiation falls on the body, if it is capable of absorb the entire amount of heat radiation falls on it, we can call it as a black body. But this concept is only imaginary, that is, there is no such body in the universe which is capable of absorbing the entire amount of heat energy falls on it. But an ideal approximation to a perfectly black body is the ferrous black body. Now I am going to draw the diagrammatic representation of the ferrous black body. This is the diagrammatic representation. this is actually a two-walled glass bulb, and the interior portion of the bulb is coated with an absorbing material, and the absorbing material which is coated here is usually lamp black or platinum black. There is a conical projection opposite to the opening, that is called the window, through which heat radiation falls on this ferrous black body. Now, when heat radiation falls on its conical projection, majority part of it is get absorbed and a small fraction is get reflected like this. When it falls on it, again majority part is get absorbed. So, after multiple reflections within the device, almost the entire heat radiation is supposed to be get absorbed by it. So, this is an approximation to a perfectly black body, and we can call it as a ferrous black body. What is the use of this conical projection? If there is no conical projection, when heat radiation falls on it, some part is absorbed and the remaining part reflected away. Now, due to the presence of this conical projection, multiple reflections takes place within the device, and we can imagine that the entire heat radiation is supposed to be get absorbed by it. Here the question is, the portion between the two walls of the ferrous black body is evacuated, and this is to prevent the loss of heat by three statements are given. One is to prevent the loss of heat by conduction, then prevent the loss of heat by convection, and third is to prevent the loss of heat by radiation. Now, if a material medium is there in between the two walls of the ferrous black body, actually heat is transferred from the interior to the exterior by conduction. Now, actually the portion between the two walls is evacuated, so we can prevent the loss of heat by conduction. Now, if air is present within the or in between that portion of the two walls, now convection takes place, or we can say that convection current takes place and heat loss by convection. Now, by keeping the portion between the two walls as absolute vacuum, we can able to prevent the loss of heat by convection also, but we can't able to prevent the loss of heat by radiation, or the loss of heat by radiation exists here. We can prevent the loss of heat by conduction and convection by keeping the portion between the two walls as absolute vacuum. So, here the correct answer is choice 1 and 2, or the statements 1 and 2 are correct. So, the correct option is A. A is the correct option. Now, I will pass to the next question. The unit of Stefan's constant is. Now, before going to explain the Stefan's constant, what do you actually mean by the Stefan's law? Now, you can imagine a perfectly black body, and this perfectly black body is one I have already told you that is capable of absorbing the entire amount of heat energy falling on it. Now, you consider unit area of the perfectly black body. You can imagine unit area from the surface of the body. Let that black body is maintained at a high temperature Tk, so it is capable of radiate heat energy to the surroundings, but here this black body is one which is capable of absorbing the entire amount of heat energy falls on it. How it is capable of radiate energy? We know that good absorbers are always good emitters. So, this much amount of, or this black body is capable of radiate energy to the surroundings. You can imagine unit area of a black body, then the amount of heat energy radiated from unit area of the black body in unit time is proportional to 4th power of the temperature of the body expressed in kelvins, or we can write E is equal to sigma into T raised to 4, where sigma is a Stefan's constant, and this relation is the Stefan's law, which is otherwise called the 4th power law. So, while we deals with the Stefan's law, the body under consideration must be a perfectly black body, and the area under consideration must be unity, then the amount of heat energy radiated from unit area of a black body in unit time is proportional to 4th power of the temperature of the body, or we can write E is proportional to T raised to 4, or E is equal to sigma into T raised to 4, where sigma is the Stefan's constant. Now, our question is, what is the unit of sigma? If you want to write the unit of a particular quantity, the first thing we have to write is, you write the equation of that. Therefore, we can write sigma is equal to E by T raised to 4, E by T raised to 4, okay. Now, you substitute the unit of E and T raised to 4, then you will get the unit of sigma. What is the unit of E? Definitely it is joules. What is the unit of T raised to 4? Kelvin raised to 4. So, joule Kelvin raised to minus 4 is the unit. Is it the correct answer? No, it is not the answer. It is absolutely wrong. Here the correct answer is, what is E here? E is the amount of heat energy radiated from unit area of the body in unit time. So, we can write the unit of E is joule by meter square, that is the amount of heat energy radiated from unit area into second unit time divided by Kelvin raised to 4. Therefore, joule by second meter square Kelvin raised to 4. What is joule by second? Watt. So, the answer is watt meter raised to minus 2 Kelvin raised to minus 4 is the correct answer. Watt meter raised to minus 2 Kelvin raised to minus 4, that is the correct unit of Stefan's constant. So, here the correct answer is watt meter raised to minus 2 Kelvin raised to minus 4 B. Option B is the correct answer. Watt meter raised to minus 2 Kelvin raised to minus 4. Okay. Now, we pass to the next question. The ratio of the rate of emission of heat by two black bodies maintained at 727 degree centigrade and 227 degree centigrade is. Now, we will explain. You can imagine two black bodies, and the two black bodies, let it be two black bodies A and B. One is kept at 727 degree centigrade, that is 1000 K, and the other is at 227, that is 500 K. These are the temperatures of the two black bodies. Now, our aim is to find the ratio of the rate of emission of heat by these two black bodies. We know that according to the Stefan's law, the rate of emission of heat energy E is proportional to T raised to 4. Or we can write E is equal to sigma into T raised to 4, where sigma is a Stefan's constant. Therefore, let E1 and E2 represents the amount of heat energy is radiated by the two black bodies. Here it is marked as A and B. Therefore, we can write E1 by E2, that is equal to T1 by T2 the whole raised to 4, that is equal to 1000 divided by 500 the whole raised to 4, that is equal to 16:1, that is the correct answer, 16:1, that is 2 the whole raised to 4, that is 16:1 is the answer. So, the correct option is C, correct option. This question is also based on the Stefan's law, and important thing here is the Stefan's law is applicable only if the body under consideration is a perfectly black body. Now, the next question. Now, in this question, two identical slabs of same materials are joined end to end as in figure 1. The figure 1 is marked here. Let us imagine two rods. The two rods are marked here as A and B, and they are joined as in the first figure, that is end to end. One end of the rod is kept at 0 degree centigrade and the other end at 100 degree centigrade. Some quantity of heat energy flows through the rod in 4 seconds, the time is given. Then, if the rods are joined as in figure 2, that is also marked in the figure, the same quantity of heat energy will flow through it in. What is the time interval through which the same quantity of heat energy flows through the second arrangement? That is a question. So, here in this question, the two identical slabs of the same material means their thermal conductivities are same. I will draw the figure here. Now, can imagine two identical rods, their area of cross section, length, thermal conductivity, etc. are the same, and they are joined end to end as in the first figure. This is your first figure. Here let the rods are marked here as A and B, and here let one end is kept at 0 degree and the other end is kept at 100 degree, and let L represents a length of one rod. This is also L, and A represents the area of cross section of the rod, and here some quantity of heat energy will flow through it through the rod in 4 seconds. This is the data is given in the question, and we know that the expression for the quantity of heat energy conducted Q is equal to lambda into A into T1 minus T2 into small t divided by D. So, we can write Q is equal to lambda. Lambda is the thermal conductivity of the rod, and there is no need of put suffix to this rod because the two rods are exactly identical and the material is same. So, lambda is the thermal conductivity. A represents the area of cross section, and T1 minus T2 is 100, that is given, one end is kept at 0 and the other end is kept at 100 degree. So, heat flows through this direction and the temperature difference is 100, and the time is also given in the question as 4 seconds divided by length. D is the distance between the two ends. Here, let L represents the length of one rod, So, the second rod is exactly similar to the first one. So, the length or the distance between the two ends of the combination is 2L lambda into A into 100 into times small 4 divided by 2L. This is the first case. Ini, when the rods are connected as in figure 2, that is, this is the figure 2, A and this is B, one end is kept at 0 degree centigrade and the other end at 100 degree centigrade. Now, the same quantity of heat energy will flow through it in what time? That is a question. So, here L represents the length of the rod and here the area of cross section of the rod is doubled. Therefore, we can write Q is equal to lambda into, instead of A, here we have to write 2A because the area of cross section is doubled into temperature difference is 100. Let small t represents the time which is to be determined and what is the distance between the two ends? Here it is L, that is the distance between the two ends of the combination is L. This is the amount of heat energy conducted in the second case. This is the amount of heat energy conducted in the first case and this is the amount of heat energy conducted in the second case. And in the question it is given that the same amount of heat energy conducted through the two cases. So, Q is same as far as the first case and the second case is concerned. So, the LHS is same. So, we can equate the RHS. So, I will do that. Therefore, we can write lambda into A into 100 into 4 divided by 2L, that is equal to lambda into 2A into 100 into small t divided by L. So, L and L will get cancelled each other, lambda A, 100, 100. So, we can write this 2, 2 is equal to 2T, therefore, T is equal to 1 second, that is the correct answer. T is equal to 1 second. So, the option A is the correct answer, T is equal to 1 second. Pass to the next question. A cubical box of side 10 centimeter is completely filled with melting ice. If the thickness of each side is 1 centimeter and the thermal conductivity of the material of the box is 100 watt meter raised minus 1 Kelvin raised minus 1. The external temperature is 30 degree centigrade and the latent heat of fusion of ice is 3 into 10 raised to 5 joules per kg. The mass of ice that melts in 10 seconds is given by some choices. I will explain the question. Now, you can imagine a cubical box, a two-dimensional figure. This is a cubical box. And the length of each side is given as 10 centimeter and the thickness of each side is given as 1 centimeter. I think it is so. Thickness of each side is 1 centimeter and some melting ice is kept within this box. Now, our aim is to find what is the mass of ice that melts in 10 seconds and the external temperature is 30 degree centigrade and we know that the internal temperature is 0 degree centigrade because the ice is kept there. So, here while doing this question, we know that heat is conducted from the exterior to the interior and that heat energy or that amount of heat energy which is conducted from the exterior to the interior is used to melt ice. If what is the amount of heat energy required to melt 1 kilogram of ice at 0 degree centigrade to 1 kilogram of water at 0 degree centigrade, definitely it is the latent heat of fusion. Let m kilograms of ice melts in 10 seconds, then we can say that the amount of heat energy conducted through the walls from the exterior to the interior, that is equal to ml because that much amount of heat energy is used to melt m kilograms of ice. Now, what is the expression for the amount of heat energy conducted, right? That is Q is equal to lambda into A into T1 minus T2 into small t divided by d and this much amount of heat energy is used to melt m kilograms of ice. So, that is equal to ml. So, in this question, the amount of heat energy conducted through the walls that is used to melt m kilograms of ice. So, lambda into A into T1 minus T2 into small t divided by d, that is equal to ml. So, our aim is to find what is the value of m. So, I am going to write the expression for m. M is equal to lambda into A into T1 minus T2 into small t divided by d into L. We can write M is equal to lambda into A into T1 minus T2 into small t divided by d into L. Here A is the area. What is actually the area here? If L is the length of each side, then we can write the area is L square. But here we have to take 6L square because we have to consider the transmission of heat energy through the 6 walls or the 6 sides of the cube. Therefore, I will write the equation as m is equal to lambda into area is 6 L square into T1 minus T2 into small t divided by d into L. Now, I am going to substitute the values here. Lambda is given as 100 into 6 into what is L square? L is equal to 10 centimeter, that is given in the question. That means 10 into 10 raised to minus 2, 10 raised to minus 1 meter. So, L square is 10 raised to minus 2. So, we can write 6 into 10 raised to minus 2 into T1 minus T2 is 30, because the external temperature is 30 degrees centigrade, which is given in the question, and the internal temperature is 0 degrees centigrade because melting ice is there. So, the temperature difference is 30, and the time is also given in the question as 10 seconds divided by d. D is the thickness of each side, that is 1 centimeter, that is 10 raised to minus 2 meter, and the LH of fusion of ice is 3 into 10 raised to 5 joules per kg, that is also given. So, do the substitution here, then we can write like this, 10. So, here 6 into 10 raised to 4 divided by 10 raised to 5, or we can write 6 by 10, that is equal to 0.6 kg is the correct answer, 0.6 kg is the answer. So, here the correct answer is option E, 0.6 kg is the answer. Now, pass to the next question. One end of a copper rod of uniform cross section and length 2 meter is in contact with the melting ice at one end and boiling water at the other end. One end of a copper rod of uniform cross section and length 2 meter is in contact with the melting ice at one end and the boiling water at the other end. So, definitely the temperature of one end is 0 degree and the other end is 100 degree. At what point along the rod a temperature of 200 degree centigrade is maintained so that the mass of ice melts is equal to the mass of steam produced in the same time interval? Here the latent heat of fusion of ice and the latent heat of steam is also given in the question. So, I will explain the question. Here we can imagine a uniform rod. Uniform rod means the cross section remains the same throughout the length. Now, we can imagine a uniform rod and the length of the rod is given as 2 meter, that is given in the question. And here one end of the rod is kept at 0 degree centigrade and the other end is kept at 100 degree centigrade, because one end is in contact with the ice and the other end is in contact with the boiling water. So, but the question is, at what point along the rod a temperature of 200 degree centigrade is maintained so that mass of steam produced in a given time is exactly equal to mass of ice melts in the same time interval? That is the question. So, this is a question. A uniform rod is there, that is the area of cross section remains the same throughout the length, and the length of the rod is given as 2 meter, and one end is in contact with the ice and the other end is in contact with the boiling water. So, at what point along the rod a temperature of 200 degree centigrade is maintained so that mass of steam produced in a given time is equal to the mass of ice melts in the same time interval? That's a question. Now, say let x represents the point, let p or the point where the temperature 200 degree centigrade is maintained so that the mass of ice melts is exactly equal to the mass of steam produced. So, I am going to write the conduction, heat conduction in this direction towards the cold end. We can write Q is equal to lambda into A into T1 minus T2 into small t divided by D. So, I will write here, that is equal, this much amount of heat energy is used to melt m kilograms of ice. So, that is equal to ml. I am going to substitute here. So, we can write like this, m into L, the latent heat of fusion of ice, that is given in the question, 3 into 10 raised to 5, that is equal to lambda, the material is same, lambda into A into, what is the temperature difference here? One end is kept at 200 degree centigrade and the other end is kept at 0 degree centigrade. So, the heat conduction towards the cold end from the point where the temperature 200 degree centigrade is maintained, the temperature difference is 200 minus 0 into time t, because the time interval is same as far as the two cases are concerned, divided by
the x is the distance between the two ends, one end is at 0, other end is at 200 degrees centigrade, and the distance between the two points is x. This is the first case, that is the amount of heat energy conducted towards the cold end. Now, I am going to write the amount of heat energy conducted towards the hot end. So, I will write here m into and the latent heat of fusion of, sorry, latent heat of vaporization, that is also given in the question, 2 into 10 raised to 6, m into 2 into 10 raised to 6, that is equal to lambda into A into, what is the temperature difference there? One end is kept at 200 degrees centigrade and the other end is kept at 100 degrees centigrade. So, you consider the transmission of heat towards the hot end, the temperature difference is 200 minus 100, that is 200 minus 100 into time, that is T, because what is the mass of ice melts in the same in the given time interval, the mass of ice melts is equal to the mass of steam produced. So, the time interval T is same as far as the two cases concerned, divided by what is the distance between these two points, that is the total length is 2, here this distance is x, so definitely this distance is 2 minus x. So, this is the second equation. So, the first equation is the heat conducted towards the cold end and the second equation is the heat conducted towards the hot end. Now, what we have to do is you divide the two equations, divide the two equations, I will write here. Equation 1 by equation 2, equation number 1 divided by equation number 2. So, what is LHS here? M and M will get cancel each other. So, we can write like this, 3 into 10 raised to 5, that is 3 into 10 raised to 5 divided by 2 into 10 raised to 6, that is equal to here, I will write here, lambda into A into 200 into small t divided by x into 2 minus x divided by lambda into A into 100 into T. Okay. Now, this lambda into A get cancel each other, this will cancel each other, small t, small t. So, here it is this one like this, that is 3 into 10 raised to 5 divided by 2 into 10 raised to 6, that is equal to 2 into 2 minus x divided by x. That is 3 divided by 20, that is equal to 2 into 2 minus x divided by x, or we can write 3x, that is equal to 40 into 2 minus x, or we can write x is equal to, right, what is that, 80 divided by 43, x is equal to 80 by 43. Here the correct answer is 1.86 centimeter from the cold end, because x is marked as the distance between the cold end and the point where the temperature 200 degrees centigrade is maintained, and here the correct answer is 1.86 centimeter from the cold end. So, option B is the correct answer. We pass to the next question. A room is maintained at 20 degrees centigrade by a heater of resistance 20 ohms connected to 200 volt mains. Repeat, a room is maintained at 20 degrees centigrade by a heater of resistance 20 ohms connected to 200 volts. Heat is transferred through a glass window of area 1 meter square and thickness 2 millimeter. So, that the temperature is uniform within the room. If the thermal conductivity of the glass is 2 SI units, what is the temperature outside the room? Now, in this question, the resistance of the heater and that is connected to 200 volts main, that is given. Therefore, we can write the heat energy created Q is equal to I square RT. So, the amount of heat energy produced in 1 second is Q is equal to I square R. That is the amount of heat energy which is produced by the or created by the heating coil in 1 second, I square into R. That is Q is equal to, I is equal to V by R, or we can write like this, V square by R square into R, or we can write Q is equal to, or we can write Q is equal to V square divided by R. This is the amount of heat energy produced by the heater in 1 second. Q is equal to V square by R. So, the value of V is given 200, that is 200 into 200 divided by resistance, that is 20 ohms. So, that is equal to 2000 joules per second, or we can write 2000 watts. This is the amount of heat energy produced per second by the heater which is kept within the room. And we know that in order to keep the temperature within the room as uniform, this much amount of heat energy is transferred through the window, and the dimension of the window is given in the question. And if the entire amount of heat energy is not transferred through the window, the temperature within the room increases gradually. And if the amount of heat energy which is transferred through the window, or the external amount of heat energy which is conducted from the exterior to the interior is high, then we can say that the temperature within the room increases. Now, here the temperature within the room neither increases nor decreases. That means the amount of heat energy created per second must be transferred through the window. And we know that the amount of heat energy conducted, Q is equal to lambda into A into T1 minus T2 into small t divided by D, or the amount of heat energy conducted per second is lambda into A into T1 minus T2 divided by D, because the time is 1 second. And this is equal to the amount of heat energy produced per second, that is 2 into 10 raised to 3 watts. Lambda into A into T1 minus T2 by D, that is equal to 2 into 10 raised to 3. Our aim is to find what is the value of T2, temperature outside. So, I write here, that is lambda is given in the question, thermal conductivity of the material of the glass is 2, and the area of the window is 1 meter square, and the interior temperature within the room is, it is not given, room is 20 degree, that is given in the question, 20 minus T2 divided by D. D is the thickness of the window plane, that is given as 2 millimeter, 2 into 10 raised to minus 3, that is equal to 2 into 10 raised to 3. Here we have to find the value of T2. Therefore, you cross multiply this relation, this 2 and 2 will get cancelled each other. Therefore, we can write 20 minus T2, that is equal to 2. Therefore, we can write T2 is equal to 18 degrees centigrade. That is the correct answer. 18 degree centigrade is the answer. So, option B is the correct answer, option B. Now, I will pass to the next question. Let 3 rods of copper, aluminium and iron are kept at 50 degree centigrade. The ratio of the thermal conductivity to the electrical conductivity of these materials in the above temperature is found to be X, Y and Z respectively. Then, some choices are given, and we have to choose the correct answer. Now, 3 rods are given. One is copper and the other is aluminium, copper, aluminium, and the third is iron. These are the 3 rods given, and all the rods are kept at 50 degree centigrade. That is also given in the question, kept at the same temperature. The ratio of the thermal conductivity to the electrical conductivity of copper is found to be X. The ratio of the thermal conductivity to the electrical conductivity of aluminium is found to be Y. The ratio of lambda to sigma of iron is found to be Z. So, of the 5 choices, which one is correct? Here, the ratio of the thermal conductivity to the electrical conductivity remains as a constant for all materials irrespective of the nature, provided they are kept at a constant temperature. That is, if all the materials are kept at the same temperature, the ratio of the thermal conductivity to the electrical conductivity, that will remain as a constant. And this statement is called the Weidman-Franz law. So, here all the rods, copper, aluminium and iron, are maintained at the same temperature. Therefore, we can write the ratio of the thermal conductivities of all the 3 rods are exactly same. So, here the correct answer is X is equal to Y is equal to Z, provided the temperature at which the 3 rods are maintained is the same. So, here the correct answer is option E, X is equal to Y is equal to Z. That is the correct answer. Okay. Now, we pass to the next question.
the black body spectrum of three different black bodies kept at three different temperatures, T1, T2 and T3 are shown in the figure. What do you actually mean by black body spectrum? That is actually a graphical representation in which the wavelength of the emitted radiation is plotted along the x-axis and the corresponding energy is plotted along the y-axis. Here, three black bodies are given and the three black bodies are maintained at three different temperatures T1, T2 and T3, and the variation of wavelength and energy are given in the graphical representation. Now, some choices are given and we have to choose the correct answer. Now, as far as the first case is concerned, now let us imagine the black body which is kept at a particular temperature, say T2, the lowermost graph, you can see like this. Here some inferences are there. At a particular temperature, the energy distribution is not uniform, because at first we can see that as the wavelength increases, energy also increases, reaches a maximum value corresponding to a particular wavelength, and that wavelength is known as lambda m, and if the wavelength is increased beyond this, energy will decrease. So, the energy distribution is not uniform. Here, as the temperature of the black body increases, wavelength corresponding to the maximum emission shifts towards the left side. That is called the Wien's displacement law. So, here three representations are given, T3, T2 and T1. We can see that the peak of T3 is shifted towards a low wavelength region, and peak of T2 less, and T3 that is least shift. Therefore, we can say that T3 is greater than T1 is greater than T2. Now, pass to the next question. A body cools from 80 degrees centigrade to 60 degrees centigrade in 10 seconds. What is the temperature of the body after another 10 seconds? Temperature of the surroundings is given as 20 degrees centigrade. A body cools from 80 to 60 degrees centigrade in a given time, that is 10 seconds. Our aim is to find the temperature of the body after another 10 minutes and the temperature of the surroundings is 20 degrees centigrade. So, for doing this question, we have to explain the Newton's law of cooling. What is actually into the Newton's law of cooling? The rate at which heat energy is radiated from a body, or we can say that the rate of cooling, is directly proportional to the mean temperature difference between the body and the surroundings. The rate of cooling is directly proportional to the mean temperature difference between the body and the surroundings. As far as this question is concerned, while I write the steps, you are maybe quite clear what is actually the rate of cooling and the mean temperature, etc. I will do that. So, take the first case, a body cools from 80 to 60 degrees centigrade in 10 seconds. So, what is the rate of cooling? Rate of cooling means change in temperature by the corresponding time. So, the change in temperature is 80 minus 60 by time 10. That is proportional to mean temperature difference between the body and surroundings. What is the mean temperature of the body? Initial temperature of the body is 80 and the final temperature is 60. So, what about the mean temperature? 80 plus 60 by 2. This is the mean temperature. Mean temperature difference between the body and surroundings, and the temperature of the surroundings is 20 degrees centigrade. That is given in the question. So, in the first case, we can write, the 80 minus 60 by 10. This is the rate of cooling that is proportional to the mean temperature difference between the body and the surroundings. So, 80 minus 60 by 10, that is 80 plus 60 by 2 minus 20. So, we can write like this. This is 2 is proportional to, here this is 70 minus 20, that is equal to 50. 2 is proportional to 50. That is the first equation, right? 2 is proportional to 50. So, that is, you simply apply the Newton's law of cooling there. 2 is proportional to 50. Now, I am going to write the equation for the second case. In the second case, how we can able to write? What is the temperature of the body after another 10 seconds? That is a question. So, what is the rate of cooling if you provide another 10 seconds also? Because the initial temperature is 60 and the final temperature is x,
and the time is 10. Our aim is to find the value of x, temperature of the body after another 10 seconds, that is 60 minus x by 10, that is the rate of cooling, that is proportional to what is the mean temperature of the body, 60 plus x by 2 minus temperature of the surroundings is 20 itself. Therefore, we can write like this, that is 60 minus x divided by 10, that is proportional to here 60 plus x minus 40 whole divided by 2. So, that is 60 minus x divided by 10, that is proportional to here it is 20 plus x by 2, 20 plus x by 2, that is your equation number 2. Now, solving equation 1 and 2, equation number 1 by equation number 2, equation number 1 by equation number 2. So, what is that? That is 2 by this one. So, 10 will comes to the numerator, that is 20 divided by 60 minus 6, that is equal to this one, 100 divided by 20 plus x. 20 by 60 minus x, that is equal to 100 by 20 plus x. So what is that? That is 40 plus 2x. Okay, 40 plus 2x, that is equal to 600 minus 10x. That is 12x, that is equal to 560. Therefore, x is equal to 560 divided by 12. X is equal to 560 by 12. So, here the correct answer is, I think it is 46.6 degree, I think that is so. Correct answer is 46.6 degree centigrade, okay. Now, I pass to the next question. A cylinder of radius r is made up of a material of thermal conductivity lambda 1, is surrounded by a cylindrical shell of inner radius r and the outer radius 2r made up of the material having thermal conductivity lambda 2. The free ends of the combined system is maintained at two different temperatures. If the system is thermally isolated, the system is thermally isolated means there is no heat exchange will take place, thermally isolated from the surroundings, the effective thermal conductivity of the system is. Some choices are given and you have to choose the correct answer. So, this is the inner cylinder, and the inner cylinder, here the radius of the inner cylinder is given as r. This is surrounded by another cylinder or the outer cylinder, and the radius of the outer cylinder is given as 2r. That is given in the question. Here the thermal conductivity of the inner cylinder is lambda 1 and the outer cylinder is lambda 2, and the two ends are kept at two different temperatures, so heat is transferred. Now, our aim is to find what is the equivalent thermal conductivity of the system, that you have to find out. So, how we can able to find the equivalent thermal conductivity? We know that the thermal, since the two cylinders are in parallel, we can write the thermal resistance 1 by R, that is equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2. This is the thermal resistance, because if the resistance are connected in parallel, the equivalent resistance 1 by R is equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2. Here R, R1, R is the equivalent thermal resistance of the system. R1 is the thermal resistance of the inner cylinder and R2 is the outer cylinder. We know that R is equal to L divided by A into lambda. R, that is a thermal resistance is directly proportional to the length and inversely proportional to area and also the thermal conductivity. Therefore, we can write like this, that is A into lambda divided by L, that is equal to A 1 into lambda 1 divided by L 1 plus A 2 lambda 2 divided by L 2. But in this question, L 1 is equal to L 2, that is equal to L, because the equivalent cylinder and the inner cylinder and the outer cylinder all of the same length. So, lambda represents the equivalent thermal conductivity of the system, and our aim is to find what is the value of lambda. That we have to find. So, here what is actually A1? A1 means the area of cross section of the inner cylinder, that is equal to pi r square, because the radius of the inner cylinder is r. So, the this one A1 that is equal to pi r r square, or pi we can write like this, pi r square. Like what is A2 here? A2 is the area of cross section of the annular cylinder which covers the inner cylinder, and the internal radius is r and the external radius is 2r. Therefore, we can write A2 that is equal to pi into this one external radius, what is that, 2r the whole square minus pi r square, that is internal radius, that is 4 pi r square minus pi r square, that is equal to 3 pi r square, that is the area A2. In a similar way, what is the area A, that is the area of the equivalent cylinder? Equivalent cylinder means that is equal to a cylinder having radius 2r, that is equal to pi into 2r the whole square, that is equal to 4 pi r square. So, here A1 means the area of the inner cylinder having radius r, A2 means the area of an annular cylinder having internal radius r and external radius 2r, that is pi into 2r square minus pi into r square, that is equal to 3 pi r square. And here A represents the area of the equivalent cylinder, that is a single cylinder having radius 2r, that is equal to pi into 2r the whole square, that is equal to 4 pi r square. You substitute all these things here. Therefore, we can write like this, that is 4 pi r square into lambda divided by L, that is equal to, here it is A1, that is the area of the inner cylinder, that is pi r square into lambda 1 divided by L, because I am not going to put suffix here, because L1 is equal to L2 is equal to L, that L, plus A2, that is 3 pi r square into lambda 2 divided by L. So, L will get cancel each other. So, we can write like this, pi r square, pi r square and the pi r square can cancel each other. So, we can write 4 lambda, that is equal to lambda 1 plus 3 lambda 2. Therefore, we can write lambda is equal to lambda 1 plus 3 lambda 2 divided by 4. That is, this is the expression for the equivalent thermal conductivity, lambda 1 plus 3 lambda 2 divided by 4. So, here the correct answer is option A. Lambda 1 plus 3 lambda 2 divided by 4, it is a correct answer. We have covered almost all the aspects regarding the chapter transmission of heat, and I think you are quite clear with all the questions that I have discussed here. Thank you.